Good evening, everybody, and welcome to our tonight's EL webinar. Tonight we'll be talking about endometriosis and diet. Before starting, we'll make a small announcement, as always, that this webinar will be recorded and we will be posting it on the EL social media and on the EL website. So by continuing to join our webinar, you agree with the fact that we'll make this recording public. Tonight's webinar will be moderated by Dr. Antonio Simone Lagano from Italy. He's a medical doctor at the Department of OBGYN, Filippo del Ponte Hospital, University of Insubria in Varese, Italy. He's habilitated as associate professor for OBGYN. He was born in Reggio Calabria, a beautiful region in the south of Italy. He's the deputy of special interest group for endometriosis and endometrial disorders of the European Society of Human Reproduction and Embryology, and also ambassador of the World Endometriosis Society. He was trained in obstetric and gynecological ultrasound at the Alta Medica Main Center in Rome. He got his master in gynecological minimally invasive and robotic surgery at the University of Pisa, a PhD in medical and surgical biotechnologies at the University of Messina, and developed an intensive training in minimally invasive gynecological surgery at the University Kliniki in Ljubljana in Slovenia during the subspecialist training program fellowship in reproductive medicine. He's also the author of more than 300 papers published in PubMed, Index International Peer Review journals. Thank you for having me here.
So thank you for this wonderful introduction. I'm very glad to chair this very interesting webinar. And I'm very glad to accept this invitation by the European Endometriosis League. Since this association is promoting a very interesting webinar about underrated topic like the one of these evening, so endometriosis and diet. So I will not lose so much time, but I would like to do a good introduction of Professor Knapp. Probably she doesn't need any introduction, but my task is to focus on her wonderful CV. And we know that Professor Knapp has been appointed professor of reproductive medicine at the Rabdu University in the Netherlands. And she is a worldwide recognized expert about fertility and endometriosis. And in her university, she established a multidisciplinary center for the diagnosis and management of endometriosis. Among the most interesting publication of Professor Knapp, there is the Reproductive Medicine Manual. She is also a pillar of the Dutch Association for Obstetric and Gynecology in the Netherlands. She played a major role during the first draft of the European guidelines for the management of women with endometriosis, and she also a member of the board of the World Endometriosis Society. So, Professor Knapp, the floor is yours. You have 30 minutes for your lecture, and then we will start the discussion. Thank you.
Before starting, I'd just like to take the moment and thank our sponsor, Gedeon Richter, and therefore I'll play a small video because they're really helping us in our educational project.
What does it take to make a medicine? You need to shift your perspective to see success comes from a series of innovations. Without the dedicated work of our highly trained researchers, no such progress would be possible. It is today that experts need to think about the diseases of tomorrow, and premium quality requires the latest technology. All these aspects come together to create new treatments that will improve the health of millions. This is what we work for every day. Gedeon Richter, health is our mission.
Okay. Thank you. I think we can start now.
Thank you very much, Antonio, for this introduction. And I would like to thank the EEL for inviting me for this webinar. It's entitled Endometriosis and Diet, What is the Evidence? These are my disclosures, and these are the learning objectives. I would like to share with you the patient's experiences about the role of diet in their suffering from endometriosis. And I would like to summarize the evidence for dietary interventions in endometriosis with you. And finally, I would like to discuss with you whether we are able to give diet-related advice to women with endometriosis. Endometriosis affects 5 to 10% of women of reproductive age. And endometriosis is defined as the presence of functioning endometrium-like tissue outside the uterus, for example, on the bowel, the bladder, the peritoneum, but also on the diaphragm, the ovaries, and in scar tissue, for example, cesarean section scar. Women with endometriosis experience severe pain, dysmenorrhea, dysuria, dyschezia, but also dyspareunia, pelvic pain, back pain. They suffer fatigue, and many of them are having problems with subfertility. It is a multifactorial disease in which pro-inflammatory, endocrine, immunologic, and pro-androgenic factors are involved. Treatment to date is medical or surgical. Medical treatment involves pain relief or hormonal treatment in order to suppress the menstrual cycle. Hormonal treatment is associated with side effects, for example, because of mood swings, and because, of course, it prevents women from getting pregnant. And also, it has only a partial effect. Surgical treatment is associated with a high complication rate, and also with only partial effectivity. More and more we know that the treatment of endometriosis is a combination of medical and surgical treatments, not only medical or not only surgical. But despite this, the effectivity of treatment is not that high, and therefore women are looking for self-management strategies. Self-management strategies are defined as skills that are used by an individual to control various aspects of life, including symptoms of diseases. Self-management is very important for patient empowerment. It's important that patients have something in their own hands that they can use to suppress symptoms. And that will help them to decrease feelings of helplessness and to increase their quality of life. Mike Armour did a study about self-management strategies in women with endometriosis. And he found that 76% of Australian women with endometriosis use self-management strategies. They chose a dietary intervention after the application of heat or the use of cannabis. 44% of the women chose a dietary intervention. And the perceived effect of this intervention was 6.4 on a scale of 10. And he found that no specific diet showed more self-reported benefits than other. So whatever diet a woman was taking, the effect was the same. And that may be the problem, because there are many diets, many advices regarding food available for women with endometriosis. They can be found all over the internet and on the social media. However, the mechanism of these diets is often unclear, and the evidence about the effectiveness is scarce. It is often not tasteful, expensive, and you have to buy your food only in organic or in biological shops. That can be expensive. And also the diet can be unhealthy if important parts of nutrients are avoided totally. And it is very important to realize that many women are experiencing feelings of guilt if they cannot adhere to the diet because it is too difficult for them to keep the diet. What do we need in order to be able to give women a good advice? We did a survey about diet in endometriosis patients, and we investigated the quality of their diet. We asked them whether they adjusted their diet because of endometriosis, and we looked for the perceived effects of the dietary interventions. How did they look at the results of the intervention? We included 157 women, all with confirmed endometriosis by ultrasound, by MRI, or by laparoscopy. And the general health score of these women was self-reported 5.9 out of 10. And their average pain score was 5.7 out of 10. So they had serious pain. And then we investigated the quality of the diet. In order to do so, we used the Dutch Healthy Diet Score. This is a questionnaire about food items, which is based on the Health Council guideline for healthy food. Across the globe, we know that a healthy diet is mainly plant-based and it is low in animal products. This translates into a diet which is rich in fruits, vegetables, nuts, fish, low-fat dairy, whole grain products, and which is low in red meat, sugar and alcohol, sweetened and alcoholic drinks, salt, and saturated fatty acids. And a healthy diet prevents cardiovascular diseases. But we do not know how healthy the diet quality of women with endometriosis is. And we looked at their diets and we found that the diet quality of all patients was significantly lower as compared to healthy female controls of the same age. But within the group of women who were using a diet, within all the patients, the women who had adjusted their diet had a significantly higher diet quality, in fact, comparable to the health controls, as compared to the patients who did not adjust anything in their diet. And we asked them whether they found if the diet affected their symptoms. And 56% experiences the diet affects endometriosis symptoms. Some food products make their complaints worse. Some food products could suppress pain. And because of this effect, 47% told us that they adhered to a specific diet. 56% said that they were using supplements. And 64% of women did change something in their diet. Specific diets were defined as the endometriosis diet. Many of them can be found on the internet. Or another specific diet was, for example, a low carbs diet or the low FODMAP diet. FODMAPs are difficult to digest saccharides. And when they took supplements, they took vitamins, fatty acids, or serrapeptase. And women who changed something in their diet said they were taking no gluten or less gluten, or they were minimizing dairy, sugar, soy, or coffee. And other women said they were taking more vegetables, more fruit, or more ginger. And all the women who were adjusting their diets had the idea that the effect was positive. So they perceived a reduction of symptoms by adjusting their diets. Removal of gluten, dairy, sugar, and soy gave the largest effect. Limited consumption of sugar, gluten, dairy, and coffee gave some effect. An addition of vegetables, ginger, and fruit also gave some effect in suppressing pain. Then we also measured the quality of life of these women, and we used the EHP30 questionnaire. And we found no differences in quality of life between patients who adjusted their diets and women who did not adjust their diets. Neither did we find differences in quality of life between the different diets. And finally, we did not find a correlation between the quality of life and the quality of the diet. The only correlation that we found was that women who were using a diet were less satisfied with the relationship with their doctor. And we speculate that it may be caused by the fact that when women are treated not so successfully. They may be less satisfied with the relationship with their doctor. And maybe because treatment was not that successful, they were motivated to change something in their diet. So in summary, we can say that women with endometriosis have a lower diet quality than healthy controls. Many women with endometriosis adjust their diet, and the women experience positive effects on endometriosis-related symptoms after adjusting their diet. But no correlation was found between diet quality and quality of life. So based on this survey, we can say women are adjusting their diet, but what's the evidence for adjusting it? In order to find an answer to this question, we did a systematic review. And I did it together with Emma Huis, who is in the audience. The effect of the review was the effects of nutrition on symptoms in women with endometriosis. And our inclusion criteria were human studies in women with confirmed endometriosis. So we excluded laboratory or animal studies. And another inclusion criteria was the effect of a nutrient in established endometriosis. So we excluded studies in which nutrients were assessed in relationship to their risk on developing endometriosis. And we did two PubMed searches. We looked for confirmed endometriosis and studies with endpoints pain or subfertility. We did one general search in which we added terms like diet, nutrition, food, nutrients, that kind of terms. This was the general search. And then we did a specific search with endometriosis, pain or subfertility, and 26 different nutrients that we had found in the literature to be correlated possibly with endometriosis. And this yielded 454 articles. After exclusion of the irrelevant abstracts, we kept 67 articles that we read in full text. And after exclusion of the irrelevant full text articles, we included 12 studies. And we graded the quality of those studies. Quality was low to very low. And we found two articles about the effect of adding vitamin D to the diet. Four articles about unsaturated fatty acids, one article about antioxidants, and two articles about the combination of vitamins, minerals, lactobacilli, and fatty acids. Those were all nutrients that were added to the diet. And then we found one article about avoiding gluten, one article about avoiding soy, and one article about avoiding FODMAPs and the relationship with endometriosis symptoms. So here you find a list of nutrients that were added, and here you find the endpoint of the study. Adding vitamin D to the diet gave partly contradictory results with regard to suppressing pain or suppressing ASRM score. This was not a clear result in the literature. But adding fatty acids to the diet gave suppression of pain, a lower ASRM score, and smaller cyst size. Adding antioxidants resulted in less pain, and adding a combination of anti-inflammatory nutrients and supplements resulted in less pain, a higher quality of life after surgery, but no effect on cyst recurrence. Avoiding gluten was associated with becoming pregnant in one very small study. Avoiding soy was associated with less pain, also in a small study, and avoiding FODMAPs was associated with less pain in a population of women with endometriosis and irritable bowel syndrome. So in summary, with regard to our systematic review, the evidence that we found may point towards anti-inflammatory effects of a diet with regard to suppressing endometriosis symptoms. However, the amount of studies that we found was small, and the size of the studies was also small. The interventions that were done were very various, and the endometriosis population were very heterogeneous. So we still are not able to give good advice. And when I went through the literature in order to look for evidence about diet and endometriosis, I came upon some issues, and I would like to discuss these issues with you. First of all, intervention. An ideal situation. A strictly defined intervention in a study has to be compared to a strictly defined control. For example, a tablet with a pharmacological agent is compared to a tablet with placebo. However, diet is not fixed. For example, the Mediterranean diet is not a fixed diet. Eating is what we are doing all day, so we cannot really standardize it or strictly define it. Moreover, a dietary intervention cannot be blinded. Possible solutions in order to make the diet as standardized as possible could be to make the intervention strictly defined by taking supplements. However, this can give the feeling of medicalization of the intervention. And that's what you don't want if you want to empower patients. If you want to instruct women to follow the Mediterranean diet, for example, or another less strictly defined intervention, it is very important that they should be taught by a trained nurse specialist or dietitian about which products they can take, which products they should avoid, how to prepare the meals, and how much they can eat. So if you instruct them well, the intervention can be as standardized as possible. And if possible, a controlled diet should be added, which is similar in taste, in energy content, and in ease of use, in order to make the results as reliable as possible. The second issue that I want to discuss with you is the endpoint of a study. Clinical endpoints that are often used are pain, pregnancy, and quality of life. And I think that we should consider to take quality of life as a main endpoint in studies regarding diet and endometriosis. Because a diet can be very effective, maybe in suppressing pain related to endometriosis, but if it is very expensive or very difficult to adhere to or very untasteful, this can negatively influence the quality of life. So we should consider taking quality of life as an endpoint in this type, in these types of studies. Other endpoints that we can take are mechanistic endpoints. For example, lesion size, ASRM score, recurrence of cysts, or inflammation markers. And these are maybe clinically less relevant, but they are very important if we want to know about the mechanism, the biological mechanism, about what is happening in the body after starting a certain diet. And it is important to realize that if we give advice about a dietary intervention, we should base this advice on the endpoint of the studies that we are using. For example, if a study shows that adding antioxidants results in pain relief, we should give that advice to add antioxidants in order to suppress pain, but not in order to increase fertility, because that's not a good advice. So we should give our advices based on the endpoints of the studies that we are using. And how about the mechanism? As I already said, endometriosis knows a very heterogeneous pathophysiology. Pro-inflammatory, endocrine, immunologic, and pro-angiogenic factors are all involved in the pathogenesis. And Palazzini and co-workers concluded after going through the literature in 2013 that different nutrients may exert different effects on different stages of disease development. And I think he's very right. So it is very difficult to see what is the effect of a certain nutrient on which part of the clinical effects of endometriosis. But we should keep looking for the mechanism. And then another issue is that we have to be aware about the difference between the association between a nutrient and the risk of developing endometriosis that is not the same as the effect of nutrients on established endometriosis. We know from the literature that a lower risk of developing endometriosis is associated with a high intake of vitamin D, citrus fruits, dairy in adolescence, and long-chain omega-3 fatty acids. And a higher risk of developing endometriosis is associated with a high intake of red meat, trans and saturated fats, alcohol, cruciferous vegetables, and beta-carotene. These are all very large and well-conducted studies. But no high-quality evidence is available for the effect of avoiding red meat, alcohol, or adding citrus fruits to suppress already established endometriosis. So it is very important to keep that in mind. There's a difference between the risk of developing endometriosis and the association with nutrients and the effect of nutrients on already established endometriosis. And finally, we have to identify patient-related factors. Which intervention is suitable for which patient? For example, patients with endometriosis often have other abdominal illnesses. And we know that a low FODMAP diet is effective for women with IBS and endometriosis. So for these patients, the low FODMAP diet could be considered first. But maybe not for all women with endometriosis without IBS. The same holds true for avoiding gluten. When patients with endometriosis and celiac disease are avoiding gluten, this will have a positive effect on their endometriosis complaints as well. But maybe avoiding gluten is not the best diet for every patient with endometriosis. And also individual differences between patients can play a role. For example, the need for patient self-management, but also how are they able to understand a diet? Are they motivated? Or do they have the capacity to a lifelong change of habits, which a dietary intervention is? Well, after having shared all these issues with you, I come to my conclusions. Endometriosis is an invalidating disease with to date a suboptimal treatment. Diet is a promising self-management tool that already is used by many patients. Many women are already adjusting their diets and they think it is successful, but it is not fully clear why they perceive it effective. The evidence that we have points toward a combination of patient empowerment and an anti-inflammatory effect. In future studies, intervention should be well defined and as standardized as possible. And ideally, a control group should be included. To my opinion, quality of life is the most relevant endpoint in many studies about endometriosis, but certainly in studies about endometriosis and diet. And we should not stop looking for the biological mechanism. I would like to thank my collaborators Nicole de Roos, Emma Huis, Pim van der Grinten, and Iris Kwabenborg. And I would like to thank you for your attention.
Wow, thanks for this wonderful presentation. I was very glad because I was learning a lot of new stuff. So actually, thank you for what you were teaching us. And so let's check if we have some questions. No, luckily no, because I have Andres question for you, because I really enjoyed your presentation. So probably I will start, since I'm also chairman, I will take advantage of my role. So you were discussing that the diet, the role of the diet is less powerful or less useful for established endometriosis, whereas it may have a good role for the prevention, primary prevention. What may be, for example, the role for secondary prevention? I mean, after excision of or surgical excision of deep infiltrating endometriosis or something like this, to prevent the recurrence of the disease. Do we have some evidence about this?
No, the evidence is very scarce. I know about one study in which they were using a combination of anti-inflammatory supplements. And the question was, is cyst recurrence slower after adding these supplements? But there was no difference between no dietary intervention and this specific anti-inflammatory intervention. So for secondary prevention, I cannot give an advice.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, let's start with the question from the audience. The first one is from Niloufer. Probably also you, Dr. Knapp, can read it. And she's asking about the food frequency questionnaire. And she said that the food frequency questionnaire have some confounding factor, for example, variety and frequency of food consumption, BMI, energy consumption for physical activity, and so on. And he's asking, what do you think that we can do to increase the evaluation of the effect of diet in the studies going on this topic?
Yeah, I think it's important to use as objective questionnaires as possible. So I know that food frequency questionnaires can be very detailed, but also they can be very general. So I think it's important to reach consensus about what is the best food frequency questionnaire that we can use. And that questionnaire should be used in all the studies. The same as that we are using the EHB30 quality of life questionnaire in almost all our studies about quality of life and endometriosis. This makes the studies more comparable. So I would suggest to reach consensus about using one specific questionnaire, but I have no suggestion which one that should be, because there are many.
Okay, thank you. So we have another very interesting question from Professor Caterina Stakoustos from Rome. Is there any relationship between diet and type of endometriosis? Because also in my clinical practice, as Professor Stakoustos is writing, diet works better in case of bowel deep infiltrating endometriosis and less in case of endometriomas.
Yes, I think you could imagine that, because if the bowel is irritated by whatever nutrients, you could imagine that if you suppress this irritation in women with bowel endometriosis, this would be more effective than in women with ovarian endometriosis. In some studies, it is really well specified which type of endometriosis is included. But in many studies, a very heterogeneous population of women with endometriosis is included, and pain is the most important item that's measured. So if they have pain, for example, a VAS score of more than 4, they can be included. And it is not so much selected by the type of endometriosis, but it is important to be aware if you give advice to women, what kind of endometriosis do you have? Can we give advice specifically to you? But we need more evidence about this.
Okay, that's perfect. So another question from our friend Alin Constantin. Are you using any flyer document regarding diet recommendation in your clinical practice?
At this moment, we are giving general information about healthy food because we have found that women with endometriosis in general do not have such a high diet quality. And then we advise them to look for themselves which nutrient is having an effect on their symptoms, and then exclude that nutrient, or if they see when they add certain nutrients that symptoms are suppressed, that they are going to use that. So we do not use a specific diet because we just think the evidence is not yet enough.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and this lead me to ask you another question, because I mean, in Italy, but also in your country, I'm sure, we are trying to centralize all the case of endometriosis in a reference center for the management of the disease. So I'm lucky, I work in a multidisciplinary team in which I have also an expert about the diet. Of course, this is not true for every hospital in the country. So what we can do, for example, in a smaller hospital in which we don't have a multidisciplinary team, Do you have some general advice for solo gynecologists or something like this?
Yes, well, a few advice actually, because in my experience, it works very well to look for a collaboration with dietitians who do not necessarily have to work in the hospital, but when you have a very interested and very well-skilled dietitian who is having his or her own practice, somewhere in the neighborhood, you can just make that your fixed referral dietitian. And of course, now with all those digital consultation possibilities for patients, it's not difficult to have contact with them. And on the other hand, if you want to give advice, I would advise to not change too many things in one time, because then if it is effective, you don't know what's causing the effect. And it can give women such a terrible feeling of guilt when they have to adhere to a diet which is not evidence-based, but which is very difficult to adhere to, which is almost impossible to have a normal life with. And for example, they feel guilty. They say, well, I'm not getting pregnant because I eat too much sugar. It's all my own fault. So that's something that I would suggest to discuss with those women. It's not their fault. And if they want to change something, let them change one thing at a time and see what the effect is. If it's not effective, then change one other thing.
Okay, that's great. So we have another question from my friend Ahmed Kale. Ciao, Ahmed. Do you offer any diet suggestion to patients who underwent segmental resection or discoid resection? And my own question is, in patients that had to undergo this type of surgery, so as preparation, do you have any suggestion?
I have no suggestion for diets before an operation. But after bowel surgery, we advise to take nothing which is irritating the bowel too much. So if you get a bloating feeling or if it's irritating the bowel, you should avoid it.
Okay, that's great. And this is another popular, very popular topic. I will give you some time to drink, sorry. What is your experience with the curcumin? Because it's very, very popular. And Alan Constantine is telling us that he has very good feedback from the patient.
I heard also incidental findings, but I didn't I didn't investigate it in a large group. But I know the individual reports about it.
Because there are some systematic reviews and meta-analyses about curcumin and endometriosis, more than one, and the results are completely conflicting. So probably we have to study more the topic. So let's check the chat. Ah, Pinar Bach. Ciao, Pinar. Are there any supplements you routinely give to every endometriosis patient? So we are talking about not diet, but supplements.
No, I don't do that. I give them the advice to have a diet which is as healthy as possible. So I advise them to follow the Dutch guidelines for healthy food. But I don't give them supplements routinely. I know many women are taking vitamin D, especially during winter. And my hope was on that. But the results of larger studies are also conflicting. So I stopped advising that.
Okay, and for example, palmito oil ethanolamide, do you know the PIA? Do you think that is a good advice, or there is not enough evidence to suggest?
Yes, maybe, there is some evidence, and I think it is a good anti-inflammatory agent. So I think it would be good to take that, yes.
Okay. So let's check the chat. This is my question. Also my question, because my fiance is a sommelier. So someone is asking about the role of resveratrol that is contained in wine.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's difficult because on one hand, of course, alcoholic drinks are not part of a healthy diet, but we do not know. It could be that the amounts of resveratrol that you have to take are so large that they are not that you cannot take it in wine daily, but then you should have to take it as a supplement. I wouldn't advise it to take that, but I know that there are studies about it.
Okay, that's great. So there is another comment from Professor Exacoustos that said, I agree that most of the endometriotic patients adjust their diet themselves, so by themselves in general, and they have a lactose-free and gluten-free diet. and asking you, do you think that we should follow this self-adjustment without to give any specific diet, so we can allow our patient to do a gluten-free and lactose-free diet without any problem?
Yeah, I think it is not a problem to use a gluten-free or lactose-free diet as long as you take a replacement, for example, for lactose. And if it does not affect the quality of life too much, because it is not easy to have a completely gluten-free life. And as long as the evidence is not there that it is really effective, I think it's difficult to advise it to women. But if it is their personal experience that they feel better when they avoid gluten or lactose, or when they only take it incidentally, that will not harm them. So that's okay.
Okay, that's great. So I have also another question in the meantime that we will wait for the question from the audience. I saw a very good systematic review published recently, I mean a few weeks ago, by Paola Vigano, it's also a old friend of mine, about the role of phytoestrogen in endometriosis. What do you think about phytoestrogen endometriosis? Do you have any advice, any evidence?
It's difficult because I think that you have to, it is a bit the same as with resveratrol, and the amount of phytoestrogen that you have to take in order to increase endometriosis related problems might be very large.
Mm-hmm.
So it's difficult to give an advice on that too.
Yeah, of course, I perfectly agree. It's a difficult topic to develop and to make research on. And so, Professor Tane Rusta is asking, is there any specific type of diet for prevention of endometriosis in young girls, adolescent girls? I mean, we are referring probably to primary prevention in this case, of course.
Yeah. Well, in one of the studies of Stacey Mismer's group, they used the nurses' health studies in order to look for association between nutrients and the risk of developing endometriosis later in life. And they found that a high intake of dairy during adolescent life was protecting for developing endometriosis later in life. But then it should, of course, be low-fat dairy. And if possible, not preferable in the form of milk, but more in the form of yogurt.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's great. So we have still few minutes, so I will take advantage also of other question. When, for example, we have endometriosis and concurrent gynecological diseases such as PCOS, uterine fibroids, can we combine the diet specific for endometriosis with the diet specific for PCOS, for example, hypoglycemia diet and so on? So, I mean, for example, for PCOS women that are usually obese, we can try to decrease the BMI as much as possible. When it is concurrent with endometriosis, it is a good advice or we should avoid it?
Yes, I think trying to decrease overweight is always a good idea, also in women with endometriosis, because in the subcutaneous fat, there's also estradiol activity, estrogen activity. So if there's less subcutaneous fat, that might suppress endometriosis symptoms. So that would be a good idea, and also to avoid saturated fatty acids and to replace them by unsaturated fatty acids may also be a good idea for both diseases.
Mm-hmm. That's great. And of course, we can also combine a particular type of diet, as you said, with a common hormonal treatment that we are used to give to our patients, of course, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, that's great. So let's check if you have still a few remaining questions. No, probably no. So if you if the audience has no other question, I would like to thank you for your time and for your wonderful lecture, and to say ciao to everyone who attended this wonderful meeting. I don't know if the European Endometriosis League would like to say something to close the meeting. Alin, would you like to say something?
Thank you for the interesting and interactive conversation.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Harald, hi.
Yes, hi everybody. I would like to say some words at the end of this webinar, and also at the end of this official webinar series for this year. First of all, yeah, Annemiek and Antonio, I would like to thank you because it was a wonderful lecture and a very good discussion. A very important topic, I think. And I would like to use the moment to thank Professor Engin Oral for his work regarding this webinar series. Engin, it was your idea when the pandemic situation just started, and I think the webinar series was a good success, and I would like to thank you in the name of the board and all the EEL members for all the efforts that you did in the last time for this webinar series. Thank you so much. And yeah, I just wanted to mention this today. And next week on Wednesday, we are going to have a special issue of the webinar, which will be about finding endometriosis using machine learning and augmented reality. It's a future project. And for those who would like to be involved in that project, it might be a good option to learn some details on the usage of augmented reality and machine learning in laparoscopic diagnostic and surgery. So I invite you to join us the 15th at 7 p.m. And once again, thank you, Annemiek and Antonio and Engin. Thank you so much.
Thank you, it was a pleasure.
Ali, now it's your turn.
Nothing more to say. I think we can wrap it up tonight.
Okay.
Thank you.
Have a nice evening. Bye.
Have a nice evening.
Thank you again.
Take care.
Bye. Bye.